relax, sit down. Just pick your feet up and breathe. Come on and smile. Don't frown. Don't get in an uproar and leave. Now, I don't mean to analyze you like some knockoff Sigmund Freud. They may be out to get you, but don't get so paranoid. Come on, relax. Sit down and have another drink on me.
Hello out there in podcast land, and welcome to Volume 2, Episode 4 of Dead Kitchen Radio, the Keith R.A. DeCandido podcast. I am, of course, Keith R.A. DeCandido. I have always enjoyed the heck out of the Alien movies, even though there's really only one of the movies that I consider to be flawless, which is the second one. Fairly popular opinion, that I admit. The first one is a classic horror movie that happens to be set in space, but the air supply to my disbelief gets cut off when they dismiss the escape pods as a possibility with the lamest of hand waves. Having said that, it's the only flaw in an otherwise superb movie, one that gives us a lot of excellent lived-in characters with distinctive personalities who go from bantering co-workers to desperate victims in a heartbeat. The revelation that Ian Holmes' Ash was an android is also magnificently handled. But as good as Alien is, Aliens is even better. For starters, the whole escape pod hand wave is given a middle finger when Hicks says, "Nuke the planet from orbit." I cheered when I first heard that line as a teenager, because it was refreshing for someone to actually take a direct approach, instead of taking a really back-asswards approach, because that's what the plot calls for. That it stopped being an option actually made sense in the plot. In addition, Ripley's PTSD from the first film is magnificently played by the great Sigourney Weaver. In Alien, she was a virtually unknown actor outside of New York's Broadway scene, but by the time of the second movie, she had made her mark as a star to be watched. It was also cool to see comedian Paul Reiser in the role of Scumbucket. The other movies are kind of hit and miss. Alien Cubed is actually an interesting early work from David Fincher, who would go on to do much more interesting movies, and there are aspects of the movie that are really good. It's also got a great cast. It's really hard to go wrong when you've got Paul McGann, Pete Postlethwaite, and Charles S. Dutton in your movie alongside Sigourney Weaver. Having said that, the way it basically spits all over Aliens is leaves a bad taste in your mouth. And while Alien Cubed... or Alien 3, however the hell you pronounce it, could have been an interesting science fiction movie, as an Alien movie, it didn't entirely work. Alien Resurrection is actually much more interesting to watch, not as an Aliens movie, but as what is very obviously the first draft of Joss Whedon's Firefly. If you watch that movie, it's pretty much the same setup. I mean, you look at the Betty, it's pretty much the same ship as the Serenity is later on Firefly. You've got your roguish white captain, your tough African-American first mate, the pilot is married to another member of the crew, and there's a thug who gets most of the best lines. I mean, honestly, Ron Perlman could have just played Jane. The thing is, and I actually saw Joss Whedon at a convention talk about this, a lot of what makes a Joss Whedon script good is the wordplay and the language. The director of Alien Resurrection was French, and English was not his first language, and had to have the script translated, so a lot of what makes a Whedon script nifty was literally lost in the translation. Having said that, if you're a Firefly fan, it's worth watching Alien Resurrection just as an artifact. Anyway, the best thing about the franchise has always been the cast of Colonial Marines from the second movie, from Aliens, from Michael Bayne's Hicks to the late great Bill Paxton as the hyperactive Hudson to Jeanette Goldstein's star turn as the badass Vasquez. In fact, Hudson and Vasquez in particular have been ripped off in virtually every other military genre movie since, and nobody has done it better than Paxton and Goldstein have. Last year, Jonathan Maberry approached me to pitch an Alien story to him that focused on the Colonial Marines for an anthology called Bug Hunt. He gathered a very impressive collection of folks who write excellent genre fiction, and just to be in the same anthology with such luminaries is a major honor for me. Some of them are buddies of mine, Larry Correia, Matt Forbeck, Christopher Golden, Paul Kupperberg, James A. Moore, Yvonne Navarro, and Mike Resnick. The rest of the table of contents is also a tremendous honor roll of genre writers, just ones I'm not as friendly with personally. Dan Abnett, Rachel Caine, David Farland, Ray Garton, Heather Graham, Brian Keene, Tim Lebbon, Weston Ochse, and Scott Sigler. apologies in advance if I mispronounced Weston's last name. Again, don't know him personally and probably mangled his last name. But sorry about that. When you go through life with a last name like DeCandido, you make an effort to get others' names right and feel bad when you don't, so yeah. Anyway, being asked to be in this anthology was just a huge thrill, given the company, and I really hope that my story lives up to it. You can judge for yourself. Here is my contribution to the big old bug hunt, Deep Background. Deep Background by Keith R.A. DeCandido. Ms. Hasegawa will see you now, Ms. Kajela. Nicole Kajela had been fearing those words since she arrived in the tastefully appointed waiting room outside the office of the CEO of the Hasegawa News Service. In the 15 years she'd been working for HNS, 10 of them as a field reporter, Nicole had never been called into a meeting in Hiromi Hasegawa's office. Hell, she'd never even met the imposing head of the corporation in person. They'd been in the same room, of course, but it was always a huge function space at an event of some kind. Nicole had only been within a few meters of her once or twice. With a sense of anticipation and dread, Nicole tucked away her notepad. She'd been composing some additional thoughts for the sidebar on her profile of Dr. Shalalabaz Rao, and approached the large metal door that slid aside obligingly for her. The first thing she noticed was that Hiromi Hasegawa was sitting behind a wooden desk. It had very little clutter on it, which surprised Nicole, as most executives had either a ton of stuff or nothing at all on their desks, but Hasegawa's was a bit of a middle ground. Then the woman herself stood up, and Nicole was amazed at how small she was. On her casts, and when she stood behind a podium, she looked like the tallest person in the room, but she barely cleared a meter and a half. Nicole also noted that the head of HNS had considerable cosmetic work done, but it was quality stuff. Had she not made an intensive study of the latest body mod techniques for a story, she probably wouldn't have even noticed that she wasn't working with original merchandise, as it were. Hasegawa walked to the other side of her wooden desk and put out a hand.
Nicole, it's a pleasure to finally meet you.
Thank you, ma'am. Nicole tentatively returned the handshake.
Oh, please, do not call me ma'am. If we were out in public, of course, I would insist on it then. But when it is just the two of us, formality is a waste of time, and do not have any to waste. Refer to me as Hiromi, please.
Not even remotely comfortable with being so familiar with the most powerful news mogul extant, Nicole simply said, okay.
Have a seat in the guest chair, please, Nicole.
Hasegawa sat on the edge of her fancy desk. Nicole did as requested.
Thank you.
Hasegawa leaned forward with a conspiratorial smile.
Please do not look so apprehensive, Nicole. You have absolutely nothing of which to be afraid.
With respect, that flies in the face of every story I've heard about meetings in your office. Waving a hand dismissively, Hasegawa said,
those are mere rumors and innuendo.
Then her smile became an evil grin.
Mind you, I started those rumors and spread that innuendo myself. I dislike meetings a great deal, so I prefer to limit their use to unpleasant tasks where at all possible, so that they may be ended with dispatch.
Worry not, however. This most assuredly is not one of those. I promise, you will depart this office with the same position and occupation and salary you had when you entered. Which, to be fair, cannot be said of many of the others who have sat in that chair over the last several years. She shifted on her butt and then got up.
This artificial wood is supremely uncomfortable. I do wish I could acquire genuine lumber.
Nicole barely managed to contain her reaction, but it was a near thing. That earned her a glare from Hasegawa's hooded eyes as she went to sit behind her desk once again.
Do you have something you wish to say in response to that, Nicole?
On the one hand, Hasegawa's tone indicated that she should answer the question, and smartly.
On the other, that same tone indicated that she wouldn't like Nicole's answer. The first, however, outweighed the second. A few years back, I did a story on the Forestry Act and how heavily regulated the use of luxury plant items is now that there are barely enough plants left on Earth to keep oxygen in the air. I got to see some real wood up close and personal, and I also talked to people who fake wood. Either what you're sitting behind is real wood, or it's a fake that is so detailed, it probably would cost more to get the real thing done than the real thing would have. To Nicole's immense relief, Hasegawa smiled. You are as talented as I'd heard and hoped. Excellent. That is precisely what is needed. Oh, and it actually is artificial wood, and yes, it would have been considerably cheaper to acquire true lumber. But I do enjoy the process of breathing, so I simply acquired the finest forgery of wood that I could obtain. Nicole nodded. She didn't appreciate her boss testing her, but she was the boss. I was speaking with Helena about you. She informed me that you were working on an exposé on Weyland-Yutani.
I was, Nicole said slowly, but I couldn't corroborate enough of my sources.
And you will not be able to. Hasegawa shook her head. The company is far too skilled at the fine art of ass covering for you to be able to obtain anything incriminating in so direct a manner. No, Nicole, the secret to finding out information that the company does not wish you to discover is to eschew directness and instead approach them sideways, so they do not see you coming. Frowning, Nicole said, Are you saying I should revive the story? The purpose of this meeting is to provide you with your next story assignment. Nicole noticed that she didn't actually answer the question. Hasegawa touched a control on her desk, and the wall behind her, which had been showing a view of the Himalayas, changed to a view of the cast on Rao that she'd been doing notes for. I looked over the draft of your profile on Dr. Rao. It is quite well done. That suffused Nicole with tremendous pride. Hasegawa was not known for uttering praise, certainly not for doing so without meaning it.
Thank you! I appreciate how you provide a deep examination into who she is and why she does what it is that she does. She is a person, not merely a subject. In addition, you provide nuance, enough so that intelligent people are able to appreciate it, but presented it in such a way that even a complete imbecile can also appreciate it. She sighed. Which is to the good, as the galaxy is quite well-stocked with complete imbeciles.
She touched another control, and the image went back to the Himalayas.
I have been friends with Emilio Cruz, the Chief of Staff of the Colonial Marine Corps, for quite a long time, and he has asked me for a favor.
Okay. That was Hasegawa's second change of the subject in the last minute, and Nicole's head was swimming.
Emilio wants us to embed a reporter with a unit in order to put a good face on them, to humanize them, in essence.
How long? Nicole asked.
For a year.
Nicole's eyes widened and her jaw fell open. Excuse me? Holding up both hands, Hasegawa started.
I realize that it sounds like a great deal. More than a great deal! I've got vacations planned. There's my family.
I can promise you that this will not interfere with a bit of it. Understand, most Marine units spend approximately 85% of their time on standby waiting for a mission, and while 75% of those missions are simple and harmless. We are not at war right at the moment, so the Marines are far more akin to security guards. They are required to be ruthlessly efficient when they are in action, but the majority of the time they are sitting on their posteriors. And worry not, as I said, you will still be allowed to take your vacation and see your family. This will hardly be an immersive assignment.
Okay, I guess, but what's the angle here?
I mean, I'm sure doing a favor for the Marines will be good for the network in the long term, but... Hasegawa smiled, and this time it was the expression of a predator about to chow down on prey. This, Nicole, is your sideways route. I'm sorry? Nicole remained as confused as she had been throughout too much of this conversation.
As I said, I have known Emilio for a very long time. It is not a single thing he has said specifically, but I am fairly certain that the Marines are in the company's pocket. I am fairly certain they may have conspired to cover up what really happened on Hadley's Hope.
Nicole blinked. You think Weyland-Yutani and the Marines are responsible for what happened there?
I think it is possible,
Yes. She leaned forward and stared intently at Nicole. There is, as they say, some shit. I want you to sniff it out, and I believe that spending a year with a Marine unit will enable you to accomplish that.
Okay. This was a little better, and it actually brought everything she'd said up until now into focus. Ostensibly, you want a profile of the Marines.
Not just ostensibly. I also wish that. Provide the same nuance that you brought to the row piece to these Marines. I have already uploaded the specifics to your queue. Get yourself a good night's rest, and then report to Lieutenant Baronato at Camp Obama first thing in the morning.
Transcript of raw footage of the interview of Private Dmitry Shostakovich Sandoval and Private Dmitry Carlos Sandoval, Colonial Marines, J Company, conducted by Nicole Cagella.
Tell me your name, please, Private, and where you were born.
I am called Private Dmitry Sandoval. I was born in Estonia, but was raised in Brooklyn.
And you, Private? Same thing, name and where you were born.
I'm Private Dmitry Sandoval, and my mommy and my papi was born and raised in San Pedro de Macorís, but this pretty face was born in Chicago.
How the hell did you both get assigned to the same unit?
Step thought it was a computer glitch, so we both showed up.
We are distinguished by nicknames. I am referred to as Big D, he is Little D.
Which really ain't fair. I ain't little, I'm just shorter than this overgrown gorilla.
Nicole's first month was spent at Camp Obama, a Marine base near the California-Nevada border. The unit she was following was J Company, led by Lieutenant Emily Baronato. J was assigned to the camp for this month to act as camp security and also to get trained on the latest weapons to come off the line. Camp Obama had, as far as Nicole could determine, absolutely no shade, which was only an issue because everything the Marines did except sleep was outside. After 4 weeks, her dark skin was practically mahogany. She watched the Marines get trained on the new M41A Mark II pulse rifles. Nicole herself had no interest in weaponry of any kind, but she knew that plenty of the people viewing her cast would want to know all about the new toys, so she forced herself to learn all about its range, how to load it, how to field strip it, how it differed from the Mark I's, and so on, which would all go in a sidebar. She also watched the Marines perform drills that involved a lot of running over bizarre terrain, shooting things that didn't stay still, and variable lighting.
But what was of most interest to her was the Marines' informal training.
One day, Sergeant Ayed Stepanian gave them the afternoon off, and six of the Marines decided to play sharpshooter poker. They took 4 beams of wood and attached 13 cards from a shuffled deck to each beam, then set them up on a ridge, one beam on top of the other. The half-dozen Marines then went 2,000 meters away and set up their M42A scope rifles. Each took a shot and had to hit a card. After they each took their turn, they shot again until they each shot 5 times. Whoever took out cards that made up the highest hand won. If you took a shot and missed, you folded. Of course, the Marines bet on who would win. Most of the money was on the company sharpshooter, Corporal Hakim Rashad. A few side bets also went on some of the others, not to mention betting on what the hand would be. By the fourth shot, everyone was out except for Rashad and Private Malik Washington, the newest and quietest member of the company. In fact, he'd arrived the day Nicole did. Corporal Lee Shu was the only one who didn't participate. Instead, he used his binocs to see who shot what and kept track of the hands.
Okay, Shu said. Rashad has 2 pair, aces and 3s. Washington's 4 to a jack high straight.
One of the Private Dmitry Sandoval's, Little D, said,
Where the fuck did you learn to shoot like that, newbie?
Washington smiled shyly. Carnival. Always won the teddy bear. Rashad took aim and fired. Shu looked through his binocs.
Ace of hearts! Full house for Rashad!
Even as Washington took aim for his final shot, Rashad grinned.
Why you bothering me? Ain't no way a straight beats a boat!
Washington, though, said nothing. Nicole just smiled. Her cam had a good zoom, and she knew exactly what cards the private had hit.
Queen of spades, Shu said after Washington took the shot. So, queen high straight. Nice, but futile. Rashad's the winner with the full house.
Cheers and attaboy sounded out as folks congratulated Rashad.
scrip also started changing hands.
Not exactly, Corporal,
Nicole said. Shaking his head, Washington said, It's okay, ma'am. The corporal said, but Nicole kept talking. Look at the suits of the cards that Private Washington hit. Shu put the binocs back to his eyes, and then his face fell.
Son of a bitch!
What?
Rashad asked, cutting himself off in mid-congratulatory cheer. Lowering the binocs, Shu said,
The reporter's right. Washington didn't get a queen high straight. He's got a queen high straight flush.
He chuckled.
Guess you got the teddy bear again.
Rashad's face fell. Nicole just smiled. Everyone else was either angry or confused. And then Little D, who was in charge of the bet money, said,
Y'all ain't gonna believe this.
Rashad turned to face Little D.
What?
Holding up both hands, Little D said,
Don't shoot the messenger. I'm just telling you what is. And what is, the reporter's the only one who put money down on the newbie.
Excellent,
Nicole said, stepping forward to claim her winnings from Little D. Shaking his head, Rashad asked,
What the hell you bet on his sorry ass for?
Because I already knew about the teddy bears. She took the script from Little D. I want to thank you all for this. It'll be a big help on my vacation to Prince Edward Island. Don't worry, though. I'll be back in 2 weeks.
What the fuck is in PEI that you want a vacation there?
Rashad asked. Well, for starters, a refreshing lack of Marines. Everyone laughed at that one. Big D said, You will be missed, Miss Gagella. He was the only one who called her that. The others either used her first name or, more likely, just called her the reporter.
Thank you, Dimitri, she replied.
Yeah, thank him,
Rashad said. Me, I'll be glad for the privacy.
You're the one who left the bathroom door open, Rashad, she said with a sweet smile. I'm off.
No, you're not.
Turning, Nicole saw Sergeant Stepanian approaching.
What do you mean I'm not? She asked. I planned this vacation a year ago, and my boss told me... I don't know what your boss told you, but my boss just told me that we're gearing up and heading to the Nelly, which is taking us to LV-418.
Nicole blinked. An actual mission? To another planet?
Okay. But I was... My orders, Miss Cagella, are for everyone to saddle up. Including you.
Transcript of raw footage of interview of Sergeant Aid Stepanian, Colonial Marines, J Company, conducted... by Nicole Cagella.
Look, you can talk to me all you want, but you should focus on the others. I'm pretty much on my way to retirement. Already filled out the paperwork.
Really? I wasn't aware of that. There's nothing in your service record about it.
Well, I haven't actually sent the paperwork yet, but I will. Probably tomorrow. Don't pay any attention, ma'am. He's been saying that for years, and we're still stuck with him.
Nicole spent the next 24 hours packing and leaving repeated messages of both voice and text with Hasegawa. Those messages garnered one response 5 minutes before she was to report to the shuttle that would take them to the Nelly in orbit.
This is why you're there. Take the sideways road.
With a sigh, Nicole reported to the shuttle after putting in a request for everything that HNS had on LV-418. In particular, she recalled that one of her first assignments at HNS 15 years ago was as a researcher on a piece about the procedure for setting up a colony, and she dug up a ton of stuff on that subject. That research would still be in the archives, and she nabbed all of it. She spent the next 6 hours canceling her vacation and failing to get refunds on anything, thanks to the short notice.
Still allowed to take my vacation. 85% sitting around. Can't believe I fell for Hasegawa's bullshit.
After 10 hours on the Nelly, they were clear of both Earth and the Moon's gravity wells, and the ship was basically a ballistic missile aimed at LV-418. She and J Company and the crew of the Nelly all went into cryosleep. The lid on her chamber seemed to rise only a second after it had closed over her, but of course the entire lengthy interplanetary journey had taken place without the need for the ship to feed or provide atmosphere for her or anyone else, not to mention the limited entertainment options in interstellar space. Her head swam as she sat up in the cryobed, trying to orient herself and keep the ship from dancing around in several directions at once.
You okay?
Nicole looked up to see a very blurry version of Private Washington looking down on her.
I'm fine, Malik.
You don't look fine. Never done cryosleep before? She shook her head, an action she regretted as it made her head spin more.
Farthest out I ever went were the asteroid mines.
Yeah, Washington said. It's kind of like a hangover the first time.
Oh, it's exactly like a hangover, Nicole said emphatically, but without the happy memories of being drunk.
Washington guided her to her feet and led her toward the mess area. Come on, he said. Best thing for a cryo hangover is lots of really terrible food. Nicole chuckled. Sounds yummy. And hey, thanks for sticking up for me at the poker shoot. I didn't want to contradict the corporal.
Hey, I was motivated. That was a lot of cash I won.
Nicole managed a ragged grin.
Listen, there's something I didn't mention to you during the interview that I wanted to talk to you about.
Nicole frowned. What's that?
You probably get this a lot, but... Well, I've been working on a novel. I was wondering if I could talk to you about writing sometime?
At that, Nicole laughed. As long as you don't want me to write a book off your idea and split the profits.
Washington looked at her askance. Why would I do that?
They joined the others for their post-cryo breakfast.
Lieutenant Baronato joined them partway through.
Just talked to the Nelly crew. Situation's worse than we thought.
What is the situation? Nicole asked.
Everyone stared at her.
Sorry, I spent the flight out trying to cancel the vacation I was forbidden from taking, she said bitterly.
Rashad laughed.
Why you want to go to PEI for when you get to watch Marines in action, poker face?
Nicole frowned at her new nickname, but decided she liked it better than the reporter. At least this one had a story behind it. Rashad kept laughing until he noticed Baronato staring at him. Then he shut up.
You gotta teach me that stare, Nicole said to the lieutenant with a smile.
Baronato did not smile back.
And you need to read the briefing materials. Short version. The planet only has one continent. There's a research outpost there. The island has sinkholes. Stuff's falling down into them. The research outpost is bugging out, and they need our help.
Relief spread through Nicole. Just a rescue operation? That's great.
Stepanian chuckled. Yeah, probably won't even break your fingernails. Or mine. Which is good, since I'm retiring after this.
Nicole rolled her eyes and continued to eat her tasteless steak and eggs.
You ain't never gonna retire, Step, Little D said.
I'm pretty sure he hasn't really filled out the paperwork yet, Shu added.
You'll see, Stepanian said enigmatically. This will be my last mission. You watch.
Transcript of raw footage of interview of Corporal Hakeem Rashad, Colonial Marines, J Company, conducted by Nicole Cagella.
What's your proudest moment as a Marine? That shit's easy. Lunar riots. This one motherfucker was beating on a woman. I put a shot in his head. Motherfucker went down.
That's your proudest moment.
Damn right. We serving and protecting and shit. And that woman got protected by my ass. That's what it's all about.
The research outpost on LV-418 had a room they called the patio, which was fully enclosed. The planet didn't have a breathable atmosphere, and had a huge picture window that looked out over the island. It was filled with weird plants in a variety of colors like orange and yellow and a lot of purple and black dirt. Much of that dirt kept collapsing into big holes, including one right under where six of the scientists were getting samples. J Company was out there in EVA suits rescuing the half-dozen scientists from the hole. Rashad, Shu, Washington, Big D, and Little D were all out rigging up zip lines and pulling the scientists out and over to the ATV, which was the only ground vehicle that was safe to move on the unstable ground. Next to her was the head of the outpost, a short woman named Aparna Pradoman. Nicole asked her,
I have to ask, Dr. Pradoman, why would you send them out there when there are sinkholes?
Simple. I didn't send them. They went on their own.
She shook her head. Morons. The Marines all had their own helmet cams, and Baronato had let Nicole watch the feed from them on her notepad with the audio in an earbud. She wasn't really paying close attention to them. It was all being recorded, and she could go over it later. And she had the earbud turned down to almost nothing. But Rashad yelling,
"Holy motherfucking shit, what the fuck is that?"
at the top of his lungs got her attention. Looking at her notepad, she saw that Rashad was down in the deepest part of the sinkhole, handing off people to Big D, who was halfway up, who then got them to Little D on the surface, and then Washington brought them to the ATV and back to the base. Shu kept an eye on the equipment, making sure that everything would hold together. She zoomed Rashad's cam feed and was stunned to see something else in the sinkhole besides, well, a hole. At first, the sinkhole just looked like a massive divot in the ground, but some of the dirt had fallen away near Rashad, and it exposed a massive chamber. that was filled to the brim with large ovals. Rashad was asking,
"What the fuck is all that?"
"Is it me?" Nicole asked, "or do those look like eggs?"
Over the earbud, Nicole heard Baronato ask, "Can we bring a sample back?" She replied, "I wouldn't recommend it. If Rashad or anyone else starts barging around down there, the hole will probably just get bigger, and we'll start losing people."
"All right," Baronato said. "Corporal Rashad, keep taking pictures so we've got something at least."
Prodoman was standing over Nicole's shoulder at the notepad display on Rashad's cam.
"What the hell is all that?"
"No idea," Nicole stared at her. "I take it you haven't seen anything like that before." Shaking her head, Prodoman said,
"I haven't, no, and I should have."
"What do you mean?" The chief scientist started to talk and then stopped.
"Never mind."
She walked away, but Nicole wasn't giving up that easily. Yet. Transcript of raw footage of interview of Corporal Lee Shu, Colonial Marines, J Company, conducted by Nicole Cagella.
"Honestly, I hate violence, hate guns, hate killing, hate exercise."
"So naturally you joined the Marines."
"You laugh, but it was natural. I mean, we're at peace right now, so there's not much combat, and honestly, I'm in it for the gadgets. Seriously, the toys I get to play with here are way better than anything I'd find in the private sector."
Night was a relative term on LV-418, as it was pretty much dark all the time, but they kept a 24-hour schedule anyhow to make things easier on the staff. The Nellie's window to head back to Earth wouldn't open for another 15 hours, so Baronato agreed to let Prodoman's people gather up everything they could and run whatever final tests were possible. They'd take the dropship back up to the Nellie first thing in the morning in what passed for morning, anyhow. Nicole finished up her notes on today's footage. It was the type of thing that most reporters loved, but which didn't interest her in the least, the team being competent. You could find footage of Marines doing their jobs right anywhere. Still, that would make a decent sidebar. She wanted to know more about the people. Her plan was to take another go at Stepanian. The sergeant had deflected her interviews with claims of impending retirement, but it was obvious he'd been saying that for a while. She was startled by the chime ringing on her barracks door. The place was tiny but serviceable. Everyone got their own bunk, which was luxury for the Marines, since the base was built for 50 but only 24 were assigned. "Come in," she said, and the door opened to reveal Prodoman, walking unsteadily in.
"Ms. Cagella, you need to see this."
She held out a data disk.
"Dr. Prodoman, are you drunk?" "Certainly hope so. I drank enough to get this way."
Nicole reached out and took the desk.
"Doc, just read that, okay? Planetary survey. Ain't no way they're in this inc..."
She swallowed.
"Incompetent."
Then her face went blank for a second, and then her brown skin started to go green.
"Excuse me."
Prodoman ran out the door, and Nicole prayed that she reached the bathroom in time. Curious, she plugged the disk into the adapter in her notepad. It only had one file on it, which contained the planetary survey made by the Wayland Corporation on LV-418 about 100 years back, done a good 20 years before they took over the Yutani Corporation. Nicole read it over and didn't find anything odd, except insofar as the sinkholes weren't mentioned.
So why show it to me?
And then she recalled that she probably had a copy of this already. The survey would have been part of the massive download she did from HNS. So she called it up and started to read it. Oh, fuck. She read it all over, and then read it a second time. This survey report in the HNS archives was completely different from the one Prodoman had just given her. Among other things, it actually mentioned the possibility of geologic instability, as well as readings indicating underground caverns that had biological readings. None of these items were in the survey that Weyland-Yutani had given to Prodoman in preparation for her expedition. They knew about the sinkholes and the possibility of some kind of alien life form and didn't tell the people they sent. Before Nicole could even begin to figure out what this really meant for her story, what Hasegawa had really sent her on, not bunking with J Company for a year, the lights went out, replaced by red lights, a buzzer sounded, and a pleasant female electronic voice said,
"Warning, biological containment detected."
Warning, biological contaminant detected. Quarantine procedures implemented. All personnel must remain inside base until further notice. Grabbing her cam, Nicole ran out of her room, down the corridor, and to the infirmary, since she figured that was where a biological emergency would be dealt with. Sure enough, Pradomon was there, clutching a mug of something hot for dear life, along with Stepanian and the base doctor, a stooped-over man named Choduck Park. There was also someone on one of the beds. Nicole activated her cam and then realized that whoever it was had some sort of thing covering her entire face. It was one of the Marines. And when Nicole noticed the lieutenant's bars on her sleeve, she realized it was Baronato.
"What the hell happened?"
Stepanian was asking. Park shrugged. "No idea. Looks like a parasite. Trying to get it off." "Try harder, Doc." Now Park looked up at Stepanian. "Everything I try, vital signs go down. I assume you prefer I don't kill her."
"That'd be nice, yeah, Doc. Then please leave. Let me do my job."
Throwing up his hands, Stepanian said, "Fine," and left. Nicole stayed behind and recorded Park's work. He kept trying different ways of getting the thing off, but alarms went off every time, and often Baronato would convulse. After a while, the doctor gave up trying any treatments, as they only succeeded in causing Baronato more distress. After an even longer while, Nicole stopped recording, as a doctor watching a patient lay still didn't make for great footage, and she went to get a nap and to try not to have nightmares about what Pradomon had shown her. The nap lasted more than 12 hours. Nicole went into the medical bay and saw Pradomon, now much more sober than the last time she'd seen her, and Stepanian arguing over Baronato's body. Park was nowhere to be found.
"We have to get out of here.
We cannot leave without the lieutenant."
"Sergeant, if we all leave except for her, she dies. If we stay here, we all die."
"The doctor said that she cannot be moved without injury. I refuse to leave her behind."
"We don't have a choice."
While Nicole was considering trying to surreptitiously record this, Park came in, sipping a can of something. "Are you two still shouting at each other?" Pradomon started.
I don't care. You're disturbing my patient."
"Your patient's in a coma," Pradomon said. "Fine, then you're disturbing me. Now please..." Before Park could continue, the thing just fell off Baronato's face.
"That's peculiar."
Park went over to check her vitals. Then she started to convulse again. And then her chest seemed to expand. Transcript of raw footage of interview of Lieutenant Emily Baronato, Colonial Marines, J Company, conducted by Nicole Cagella.
"Please stop trying to talk to me. I understand that General Cruz specifically requested you here, but while I am under orders to allow you access to my unit, I have received no orders that force me to talk to you. Go away."
Nicole sat in the patio, behind a huge barricade that Rashad and Washington had constructed. She was next to Stepanian, who was covered in horrid burns from the acid blood spewed by the creatures, whatever they were. They were the only ones left. At first, there had just been the thing that exploded from Baronato's chest, but then more appeared. Nicole had no idea where they'd come from, but they overwhelmed the base within a day. Rashad looked at Washington.
"How much you got left?"
3 clips, and the flamethrower is still in good shape. Then Rashad turned to Nicole.
"How's Step?"
Nicole shuddered. "He doesn't look good."
"Motherfuck, what are those damn things?"
"I don't know," Nicole said, "but the company knew about them and kept it from Pradomon and the others." Nicole shuddered. Stepanian and Little D had gathered the expedition team in the mess hall, and they'd wound up trapped there by the creatures. The sergeant was the only one to get out alive, and at that had been crispy fried by the acidic blood. The monsters had picked off the rest of the Marines one by one. Then Nicole said,
"Do you know what happened to Shu?"
"He's dead like everyone else," Washington muttered.
"Did he make it to the communication room? He was supposed to send a message." "The fuck point is there in a message?"
Rashad asked.
"Ain't nobody gonna hear shit for 2 weeks. By the time they even know we're in trouble, we'll be dead."
"Because they have to know," Nicole said.
"This is why I was sent on this assignment, don't you get it? The company knew about these things, and they didn't tell Pradomon's people or you guys."
Rashad shook his head.
"Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. I got no fucking clue. And the comm room's got a big-ass hole in it that Shu and Big D made. Took out 6 of them fuckers with him, for all the good it did."
Washington was staring down at his motion detector, and he suddenly cried out, "They're coming!" Nicole reached out over to Stepanian's holster and removed the pistol. "I'm sorry, Step. I guess it really was your last mission." She got up and stood next to Washington, taking the safety off the pistol. Washington looked down at her. "You know how to use that?" "We'll find out, won't we?" He snorted. "Yeah. Guess I ain't gonna get that novel finished, huh?" "Nope." She aimed the weapon over the barricade. "I just hope Shu was able to get my last story out." Transcript of raw footage of interview of Private Malik Washington, Colonial Marines, J Company, conducted by Nicole Cagella.
"So what's the novel about?"
"Well, it's about these two people who meet for the first time on Luna, and then they get separated when her parents get reassigned to Earth, and they both live crazy lives only to find each other again when they're both in their 90s, and they pick up where they left off. So it's a love story. Kind of?" Hiromi Hasegawa read over the transmission that had been sent from LV-418 2 weeks ago directly to her queue. The sender code belonged to the Colonial Marines, but the ID was Nicole Cagella's. Based on what she read, Nicole was probably dead, along with the rest of J Company, but not before she uncovered the story of the century. The files appended to the message proved once and for all that Weyland-Yutani had deliberately hidden the existence of xenomorphs on LV-418. Hiromi shook her head. "I knew you were talented, Nicole. Well done." Then she deleted the entire message. She put a call through to General Emilio Cruz on his personal line. Cruz was in the Philippines right now, so it was 4 a.m, and he'd probably be asleep. Sure enough, in a bleary voice, Cruz asked,
"Hiromi, do you know what time it is?"
"Yes, Emilio, I am fully cognizant of the time, but I didn't think you'd want to wait to hear that I was right. Weyland-Yutani didn't cover their tracks well enough. One of my reporters almost exposed the xenomorphs on LV-418. Cruz's eyes went impossibly wide, and sweat was already starting to bead on his forehead. "Are you calm yourself, Emilio? I've already killed the story, and the xenomorphs have done the same for my reporter. And J Company, by the way." Waving an arm, Cruz said, "Nah, I'm sure they died heroically. It's what they're supposed to do." He blew out a breath. "Good work, Hiromi. I'll let the Weyland-Yutani board of directors know. I'm sure they'll compensate you well for this information, just like usual."
"Good."
She smiled. "Sleep well."
Aliens Bug Hunt will be available this very month from Titan Books. They'll be at finer bookstores everywhere, as well as many of the lousy ones, and also via all the usual online retailers. The official pub date is actually the 17th of April, which is the day before my 48th birthday. By a startling coinkydink, the 17th of April is also the last day of funding for Mermaid Precinct. This is the long-awaited fifth novel in my series of high fantasy police procedurals, which I'm funding via Kickstarter. You've heard me on past episodes of Dead Kitchen Radio talk about the previous books in the series, including Unicorn Precinct, Dragon Precinct, Goblin Precinct, Griffin Precinct, and the various short stories and tales from Dragon Precinct.
We've already made our $5,000 goal for the book, so it's happening, no matter what. If you pledge, you're guaranteed to get whatever it is you pledge for. And we've got not only lots of nifty rewards in the regular Kickstarter, but we've also got a bunch of stretch goals going, one of which is me doing an audio of the novel. So if you like the way I read things here on DKR, you should definitely go for that. So go to Kickstarter.com and search for Mermaid Precinct, or I'll have a link up in the show notes for this episode on deadkitchenradio.wordpress.com. Other new work of mine that's floating around out there for sale are the three Super City Cops ebook novellas, Avenging Amethyst, Undercover Blues, and Secret Identities, which I talked about on Dead Kitchen Radio three episodes ago. They're available from all the usual online retailers. There's the first two books in the Tales of Asgard trilogy, Marvel's Thor dueling with giants, and Marvel's Sif, Even Dragons Have Their Endings. The third book, Marvel's Warriors 3, Godhood's End, is due in May, and I'll be talking about that whole trilogy on next month's podcast. There's Baker Street Irregulars, which is an anthology of alternative Sherlock Holmes stories, edited by Michael A. Ventrella and Jonathan Maberry. I talked about that last episode. It has my story Identity in it. And there's also my Stargate SG-1 novel, Cully's Wrath. I've got my usual slate of public appearances. Actually, I had a ton of them in March and April. It's slowing down a bit now, thank goodness, because I'm really tired. However, at the end of April, the 28th to the 30th, I will be one of the author guests at ZenKaiken 2017, which is in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. For more information, go to zenkaiken.com. That's ZenKaiken.com. From the 26th to the 29th of May, which is Memorial Day weekend, I will be one of the many author guests at Balticon 51, which will be held in Baltimore, Maryland. For more information, go to balticon.org. Over Independence Day weekend, which will be the 30th of June to the 2nd of July, I will be the Toastmaster at In Conjunction 2017 in Indianapolis, Indiana. For more information about that, go to inconjunction.org. And the following weekend, the 7th, 8th, and 9th of July, I will be one of the many author guests at Shore Leave 39, which will be held in Cokeysville, Maryland, just north of Baltimore. Go to shore-leave.com for more information on that. And as usual, I will be at Dragon Con over Labor Day weekend in Atlanta in September, and lots more beyond that. There'll be links to all those conventions in the show notes. Finally, on the 22nd of April, I will be marrying my fiancé, Ren Sims. So by the time the next episode of Dead Kitchen Radio hits, I will be a happily married man. Dead Kitchen Radio is a monthly podcast discussing all things crad. You can find us on the web at deadkitchenradio.wordpress.com, which will include show notes and links and all sorts of other stuff. We also have a page on Facebook, which you should feel free to like. Just search for Dead Kitchen Radio, the Keith Arieta Candido podcast, on Facebook. You can leave comments at the WordPress site, at the Facebook page, or send email to me at keith@decandido.net. You can also comment at my blog or my Facebook page. Gateways to those places are at decandido.net. You can also follow me on Twitter at Kradec, K-R-A-D-E-C, and on Instagram at crad418. Dead Kitchen Radio was recorded by Keith R.A. DeCandido, produced and edited by John S. Drew, with music by Steve Rosenhaus. Dead Kitchen Radio is part of the Chronic Rift Network. For more information about the network, go to chronicrift.com. Until next time, when I'll be talking about the Marvel's Tales of Asgard trilogy, this is Keith DeCandido saying, good night.
Now what goes will come around again, and forgive my being crass, but you know those boots of karma, we'll just kick them in the ass, so just relax. Sit down and have another drink on me, and have another drink on me.